Hi there, this is Valentine and welcome to another Postman tutorial. Authentication and authorization is complicated. And especially when we're discussing about OAuth 2, things get really, really messy. So in this tutorial, I will try to explain to you the fundamentals of OAuth 2 and at the same time to show you a very simple example that can be done with Postman. So let's get started. I wanted to start with a very simple example. I like to take some pictures and you can see I have here a Dropbox folder and I store them here. In this picture that there are also other people in the background. I've created an app that can put a smiley face on top of everyone that's in the picture apart from me. This has worked pretty well with my own Dropbox account because I can give the username and password to the app and the app can download the photos and recognize where to put a smiley face. A friend of mine also wants to use my app to add these smiley faces to other people that appear in his photos. And he's totally uncomfortable giving his Dropbox username and password to me, practically to my app, in order to achieve this. So I heard about this OAuth thing and wanted to show you how you can use OAuth in order to access some data, for example, from Dropbox. Same principle applies to any other kind of application where you have somebody else not trusting you with his or her username and password, but you still need a way to access some data. So in the case of Dropbox, this is very nicely explained on the Dropbox website. What we have here is an OAuth 2 flow, and OAuth 2 is the protocol that makes this magic happen. What's happening in this case? Well, you have a user, for example, my friend, and this is the app that I have developed. In this case, is this image gallery app. In my case, I have this smiley app. What will happen, and I'm sure you will see this with many services, will ask for permission. I will send a user from my app, which can be a website or can be a mobile app, to the Dropbox servers. And here at the Dropbox servers, the user will be asked something like, hey user, in this case Panda, is it okay for my smiley app to get access to your files so that they can add the smiley faces? And he says, yes, of course it's okay. And then my app can then access the images. But what's happening in this flow is that at no point my friend has to give up his username and password in order to allow for my app to access the files. This is the OAuth 2 flow. It's called the flow because it's a series of steps that need to ensure security. And this entire thing is to avoid handing out credentials to different services. Dropbox here is just an example. You've probably seen it a lot with Facebook or any other services where it appears app X wants to have access to your email address and to your friends list, but is not allowed to post, for example. This is an example of OAuth. You're going to Facebook and there you click, okay, I accept, I agree with this, or I don't agree with this. And then this app can do things with your account. Hopefully things that you have only agreed to. Now, we have a specification for this OAuth 2 thing. It's quite complex and oftentimes it's so misunderstood and so hard to navigate through it. Now, I'll try to explain everything in simple terms so that you can follow along. But it will take a bit of time, so just hang on with this tutorial because by the end, I'm sure it will really help understand how things work. Now, there are different kinds of flows in OAuth. So, for example, this is called a flow. The most popular one is this, the authorization code grant. What I'm going to do in this video is we're going to use this authorization code grant and we're going to demonstrate this when using Dropbox. And we're also going to use Postman in order to interact with it. This smiley faces app is something that I've made up. It doesn't exist. But the same principle still applies, so don't worry about this, it will still make sense in the end. If you look at this flow, you can notice that it's not so nice as the one from Dropbox, but I will still explain a few things. You may notice many terms here that probably don't make a lot of sense, like, first of all, what's an authorization code grant, what's this resource owner, and so on. So I'm going to start here with this diagram and try to understand the basics, and after that, I'm going to start doing and I'm going to explain along as we do things. I don't want to give you a lot of theory in the beginning so that it doesn't make sense in the end. But the main idea is the following. The resource owner is, for example, my friend. Let's call him Jake. Jake has this Dropbox folder and he has there a lot of images. The authorization server in this case is also Dropbox, so dropbox.com, where he goes and enters his email and password and can see all these images. The client is the application that I'm building. In this case, the Smiley Faces app. It can be a website, it can be an app on a mobile phone, it can be anything. They're called clients. And the user agent, in this case, is simply the browser. What you use in order to go to Dropbox, in order to enter your username and password, not the app itself that you have installed on your computer, is the browser that you go and see your files. What's happening? So the flow goes in the following way. I have Jake coming to my Smiley Faces app, and I ask him, hey Jake, you're not connected with Dropbox. I cannot see any files. If I cannot see any files, I cannot do anything. We need to get you connected with Dropbox. And typically you would see like this button there, like connect with Dropbox or connect with anything else, Facebook and so on. The first step is to get permission from Jake in order to access his files. This is where the flow starts. And I'm going to create a request with an address pointing to Dropbox, where I'm also identifying myself as a client. This is the client identifier. Sort of like, well, try to log in Jake. So just as you know, I'm the client, I'm the application Smiley Faces, in case you're interested, Dropbox. And then Jake, if he's not logged in, will have to enter his username and password. If he's logged in, he'll be prompted with a screen where it says, do you want to allow access to your account to this app called Smiley Faces? When Jake clicks on yes, I agree, an authorization code will be sent back. And then later on, this authorization code will be exchanged for an access token. And then finally, with this access token and the client, in this case, my Smiley Faces app, go again to where the Dropbox images are stored and say, hey, give me the images or give me a list of all the images and I will see what I will do with this. In this scenario, at no point I have the information what is the user and the password of Jake. I only have in the end this access token, and you can see this access token as a temporary password. I know that by now things are just as confusing as they have been, but trust me, when I will show you this live example, it will start making sense. Now, the first step is to register the application, my Smiley Faces app, with Dropbox, because you cannot simply access any data from any server, for example. You have to first register. So for that, I'm going to go to this app console. And by the way, everything I'm talking about, you will find links in the video description. So make sure you check that out. Also in the video description, I'll be posting any updates just in case something changes, you know, interfaces change, Postman changes. So as you can see here, I haven't created any apps. So I first need to register my app with Dropbox. Otherwise, Dropbox, even from the first step, it will not know who is this Smiley Faces. I don't know it. So this is why we have to register it first. I'm going to select here the Dropbox API. And it says here quite obviously for apps that need access to files in Dropbox. So this makes sense. And just to make things a bit more secure, I'm not going to request full access to Dropbox. I'm just going to request access to a specific folder. So Jake will only put the photos that he needs Smiley Faces on in this specific application folder. And now, as a final step, I have to name my application so that when Jake is prompted with the screen, he will be able to know, oh, this is a Smiley Faces app that's requesting access and not something else. So I have now everything that I need. As this is in a development status, the only development users that will be able to access this application is me. Of course, you can also enable additional users, but I'm going to demonstrate auth flow with me, also the creator of the application and also the owner of the images. As soon as I've created this application, Dropbox has generated some information. And this is quite important to notice here. You will see here the app key and the app secret. This is like the username and the password for my app. This is something that only I should know. I don't want to share this information with Jake. So this will remain somewhere when I can store it safely. For example, if my app has a backend server with backend code doing things with images, then this is where I would probably store the key and secret. Now, because my Smiley Faces app doesn't actually exist, I'm going to use Postman instead of the app. So Postman will be the client. I'm going to store these details in Postman. I'm going to copy this, go to Postman. And the first thing that I want to do in Postman is to create a new environment. So I'm going to click here on the gear to manage the environments. I'm going to click Add, and right here, Dropbox. So this will be the location key. The application secret. One of the next things I need to do is to configure a redirect URL. Now, regardless if I have a website where I have the Smiley Faces app or I'm building an app, auth still works over HTTP. The redirect URL is important because the redirect URL is where the user will be sent after he or she has granted permission. So after Jake has clicked on, yes, I accept to give Valentine's Smiley app access to my Dropbox folder, then it will be sent to this URL. So I need to specify it. Now, typically, if you have a website or you have an app, you will be able to specify that respective address. But since we don't have this, we're going to use something from Postman. And the address that we're going to use is this one. We'll find it in the video description. You don't have to type it. What this will do is it will redirect back to the Postman app. Additionally, we're going to not use this implicit grant. This is a different kind of flow. So I'm going to click here on disable, or disallow to be more exact. This should be it. Now we have all the information needed in order to get started trying to access the files. Now in Postman, all you have to do is to open up a new request. And we're going to go straight to authorization. And from the list, I'm going to select auth2. And next, I'm going to click on get new access token, because this is the final goal. Without the access token, we cannot go to Dropbox and say, trust me, Jake said that it's okay to access those images. No, we need the access token. Now, as soon as we click this, boom, there's a lot of information that we need to fill in right from the beginning. And there are two things that we already have. We have the client ID and the client secret. Again, the client is the app, is what is trying to connect to Dropbox. In this case, we have named this app ID, so app key and app secret. I'm going to use this syntax in order to access this environment so that we don't store any credentials here in the request itself. It's just simply a good practice. If I hover over the variable, we'll be able to see the current value. Great. Now, we still need a few things. You can see here that the callback URL is already configured to what we have configured on Dropbox, the same address. And this is super important because we cannot specify a different callback URL than we have indicated to Dropbox for security reasons. Additionally, the grant type is authorization code. And this is the flow that we are discussing here, the authorization code grant that we have here in the image. So it's important that you select authorization code and not something else. Okay, so we have the grant type. This is what kind of flow are you trying to use, the grant type. The callback URL, this means we're going to be sent back to Postman. We're going to check here authorize using the browser. If you disable this, you will see a bit later what's happened. But for now, we're going to leave it here enabled. And now we still need two different things. We need here the auth URL and the access token URL. These are two different endpoints that are specified in the auth specification. In order to figure out where these endpoints are, we have to go back to the Dropbox API documentation and to get them from there. On the Dropbox side, things are pretty well documented. When you're doing auth, if you're looking for the authorization URL, it will typically be something with auth2/authorize or auth2/auth. So this can make it easier for you to understand from where this is coming. I'm going to copy paste this. And we also need the access token URL. And again, the access token URL will be also part of the documentation. Just have to scroll a bit. I'm going to find here, this is the endpoint, auth2/token. Make sure that you don't include any spaces or any new lines. Okay, so what's happening next? Let's do the following. I'm going to click here on request token. And you can see I'm being redirected to my browser. This is an address that Postman has generated. It has generated this based on the information that we have. So let me quickly copy this just to explain what is the contents of this. So this is the URL. Obviously, this first thing is the endpoint, so let me make it a bit bigger. With the first query parameter that we have used, response type code, we are telling Dropbox this is an authorization code grant. This is the type of auth to flow that we are using. This state is obviously empty, so it doesn't have any importance here. Additionally, we have the client ID. This is the same client ID as we have received it from Dropbox, so we can easily check it. You can check this is the app key, so this identifies the app. So now for Dropbox, the app is not called Valentine's Smiley Faces app. It's actually called as the app key indicates. So this is the technical ID of the app. We haven't indicated any scopes, and this is empty, and scopes altogether are a different topic. And as you can see, the redirect URL is the so-called callback URL, the URL where the user will be taken back. Now, because Dropbox can support different redirect URLs, we also need to specify it not only when we configure the app, but also when we are doing this authorization step. This is all what happens. We practically send the user from our app by simply, when you click that button, you make a GET request, you open your browser, you go to dropbox.com/auth2authorize, and you see this page here. Now, this is still a warning because this is an app in development. I'm going to simply close it now and restart it from Postman once again. I just want to break down what's happening in this initial step. So obviously, we had waited a bit too long with explanations. So I'm going to click again, request token. I'm going to be sent again to the website. This is just a warning. I'm going to click continue here. And now finally, and I might make this a bit bigger. This is the typical screen that you get. It says Valentine's Smiley Faces app would like access to its own folder. And it's in apps, and this is the folder name, inside Dropbox. And now you can decide to allow or cancel. Now, when you click allow, this is when you're here on the authorization server. So you have been redirected to the authorization server. I've already been logged in. So just in case you haven't been logged in, you're asked for username and password. And then the next step would be to get the authorization code. Practically, the authorization code is telling me that you have agreed to the access. And I can also later demonstrate to Dropbox the user has really clicked on accept. I'm going to go to that just in a few minutes. So I'm going to click here, allow. And what's happening here? And this is, again, super important. We had clicked this URL, and it has been sent to the callback. And a callback does something a bit different in the sense that it then redirects to postman/app because this is like an internal protocol that then the browser knows to open the app. So this is the way it says here, open Postman. So I'm going to open Postman. And no worries if this failed. We're going to look into this in a few minutes. But so what's important to notice right now is that we have this response. So now the user has agreed and has been sent to our callback URL. You will see here that we have received this code. With this code, we can then request an access token. So this is super important. It may happen that authorization fails. No worries about this. I'm going to simply close this for a second. And typically, nothing is going to work from the beginning because auth2 is a bit complicated and any misconfiguration that you make can lead to undesirable results. So for that reason, it's really important that you open the Postman console. The Postman console is here on the left corner. It's a bit hidden, but it's a super important tool. So click on it. You will see here what kind of requests have been sent. So the last request that has been sent is this post request. And in this post request, you can see that in the request body, we have sent some information. Again, we are talking here about the grant type. This is when we are trying to get the token. So you can see we are finished now with the first endpoint that we have defined. So now we are going to the token endpoint to try to get the token. So you have this user confirmation, which is here. It's the same that came through the callback URL. What we're telling now is we're going to the server and we're sending our client ID and client secret and telling me, this is the app. Here are my credentials. This is my client ID, client password. The user has agreed to give me access. Now give me an access code so that I can do my work. This is what's happening in this request, to be very simple. Unfortunately, we got an error here. So we have to understand what has happened. What has happened can be easily inspected from the response body, but also the error that you can see here. So could not complete auth to token request unknown field client ID. No worries about it. There's a configuration that we still need to change. So I'm going to click here again on get new access token. And also for the client authentication, again, this is when we're going with a client to Dropbox and saying, this is me, trust me. And here are the details that you gave me, the app key and the app secret. This is why we had to add them here. They were not used for the first request because we don't want to give these secrets to the client. They are needed for the second request that goes to the access token URL. Now, the client authentication can be done either by setting a header with this information. It doesn't work for Dropbox. And for that reason, I'm going to send the credentials in the body. I'm going to check this to send client credentials in the body. So instead of sending it as a header, I'm going to send it as part of the HTTP request body. So I'm going to try again, request token. Again, I'm going to be sent to Dropbox. I'm going to click on continue. Yes, I'm allowing. And I'm coming back. Again, this is the authorization code in the address that you can see. I'm opening Postman, so then Postman can have access to the authorization code. Authentication is complete. Now we have the access token, finally. So what has happened? We go back to the console. We can see again the same request that we have sent. This is a post request. And this time in the request body, we have sent the following information. We're specifying the grant type. Just to be explicit, it's in the protocol. We're letting know Dropbox what we are trying to do so there's no confusion. We're giving the code that we have received. You can look again and compare it. So this is the exact same code that we have retrieved here in the address from the client, specifying again the redirect URL, and we're giving the client ID and the client secret. We want to be able to get the access token in the app, and this is typically much more secure, especially for backend application. We're talking about a frontend application. This will not make sense because a frontend application will not have access to the backend. So for example, if you're building an Angular application or React app, you will need not to do the authorization code grant, but you will need to do an implicit flow. And I'm going to go back to that immediately. Just let me finish with this one. So this is what has happened here. So we went to Dropbox. We have sent all this information. We have exchanged the code that we have. Dropbox responded with this access token. So now with this access token, we can actually go and do things. I'm going to show you in a second what kind of things we can do. What I'm going to do here, I'm going to go to my Dropbox folder and I'm going to simply move this file that we have here. I'm going to select apps. And from the apps, I'm going to select Valentine Smiley Faces app. I'm going to move this here. So if I'm looking here inside the folder app, I'll be able to see my Apple Store JPEG file that I have. And for this image, I want to have smiley faces. This was only the part needed to get access to the account. Now we have to take a look at how we can use the API. Not going to get very deep into this. I'm just going to try to list all the files that are available inside here. Let's go, for example, to the developer documentation again and search something like list. So this is the URL structure that we need to have. And hopefully this will list files that are available inside a specific folder. Simply close this now. And this is the request that I'm sending out. It has to be a post request. We have here a list of available tokens. I'm going to select one of them. I'm going to send this request. I'm getting this error here, like this app is currently disabled. It's definitely not disabled. Let's try to delete this token that we have here and try to do the entire flow once again. I'm gonna ask a new token. back to the app. So the entire screen doesn't appear anymore because now I've already granted access. Session is complete. Now, additionally, we need to specify some parameters. So I'm going to simply copy from the example here in the documentation. Go back to Postman and make this a post request. The raw, paste here JSON. And I'm going to make the path simply empty because I'm going to get from the root. And actually, I don't care from the rest of the parameters. And now you'll be able to see in the response, I'm getting a list of files. And this is the only file that I have in the folder, meapplestore.jpg. So this has demonstrated how to get access to these contents, how to use this. So if we don't have this access token, we cannot go and request this data. As you can notice, the access token is linked to the user. We do not need to specify the user somehow separately. We don't need to know the email or anything like this. It's actually linked to the data that we're trying to access and if we have permission to access this information. So for that reason, OAuth doesn't deal with authentication. It deals with authorization. This is a very important distinction. It allows us to access this information as soon as we have this access token. If we're looking at this request, we're not sending anything else. This is a simple post request when we are getting here this information from the endpoint. The only information that we're giving is this bearer token. So this is an authorization header. It's here called bearer. This is what we have. So we're sending the token here. And this is all that we need. We don't need to specify the client ID or the client secret or anything like this, because this is a different server altogether. So going back to the flow, for example, even though we're referring to Dropbox as this website and it looks like there's only one thing out there, actually, the only part that deals with the user itself is the authorization server. It's where the user is redirected and told, do you allow access to this app? When we're trying to get this information regarding the images or what's the contents of the folder, we may be going to a different server altogether. Even if it looks to go at dropbox.com, it's a different thing. In practice, they may be on the same physical server or the same application, but typically they tend to be separated. The idea of separation is to have a server or an application doing one job, for example, handling user authentication and user permissions. And at the same time, to have other servers that are only handling data, for example, the contents of the folder. And then I can go to these servers. They have no idea regarding any user or whatsoever. I just have this token. I'm saying, I have this token. Show me the list of files in this folder. And then what the server will do will get this token and will validate it with the authorization server. Say, hey, I have this token. Is this valid? And the authorization server will say, yes, this is valid. You can give access. So it's just trying to separate the responsibilities of different kind of applications within this entire infrastructure that we have. Two more things I wanted to show you. First of all, when you're clicking here, get access token, if you disable this, you can still leave this callback URL. When you're requesting the token, you will be given this window, which starts within Postman. You can still follow along in the console and see which requests are being sent. I didn't do this because Dropbox will not recognize that I'm logged in. I need to log in and then confirm many other things. So it will treat from the security point of view as an untrusted source. It's much easier with the browser, but I just wanted to point this out as well. If you remember, inside our app, we have also disallowed this implicit grant. And I just wanted to spare 2 minutes and quickly talk about the implicit grant as well. When we're doing the implicit grant, we are changing things a bit. And I want to quickly explain how this goes as well. Let's open up a new tab. I'm going to go to authorization, select OAuth 2, get access token. This is like, I'm going to call the token name implicit. You will see here the grant type that I need to select is implicit. And there are a few things that change here. You can see from the beginning, we have no longer a token URL. And we also don't have to provide the client secret. So we only provide the authentication URL, we provide the client ID, and we're sending the client to get a token. What's happening in this case is we have only granted access. The first step of this flow is absolutely the same. The user will be prompted to give permission to the app, and then we will be given a callback URL. Now, this time, in this implicit flow, the callback URL is different. Let me open this up here so that you can easily see it. In the callback URL, we already have the access token in the response. It's being sent to the user agent, the browser, or the app through the URL. So this means the client application doesn't have to go and exchange the authorization code to get an access token. The access token is delivered immediately. Obviously, this is a much easier flow, but also from a security standpoint, is less secure because then you will have this information lying maybe in the browser. You actually don't want to have it there. But you can see here directly, we have now the access token and it's explained that's the bearer type and so on. But this is an important distinction, at least at a very basic level, between the authorization code grant and the implicit grant that we have in OAuth2. And these are the most used flows that you will encounter. The other two that are available are not so popular. I hope this information was useful and that you managed to understand how to use OAuth2 in Postman and that it managed to give you a better understanding how everything works. In the end, everything is just HTTP. If you open the Postman console and take a look at what's going on, this entire interface that you see here is just made so that you can easily work with these things, so that it eliminates a source of errors. In the end, what's happening is simply HTTP request. So you can go open up any new tab and write the same URLs to be able to do OAuth without any of these helpers. Hope this tutorial was helpful. If you have any questions, make sure you drop a comment in the section below. Check the video description because I'll be posting updates or additional material and information that are relevant for OAuth2. And hopefully see you at another Postman tutorial. Please consider subscribing. See you next time. Bye-bye.